What you can see here is the exterior panels of Hieronymus Bosch's masterpiece, The Garden of Earthly Delights. Evidently, in a closed condition, the triptych does not show much delight at all. What we see instead is a grayish pre-Copernican representation of the cosmos, the yet unfinished cosmos on the third or fourth day of creation. We see the Earth as a flat disk contained in a glass-like sphere, and this is probably an allusion to Psalm 33, which says that God gathers together as in a bottle all the waters of the sea. The same Psalm 33 is also quoted in the inscription on the painting, which reads, "Ipse dixit et facta sunt, ipse mandavit et creata sunt. He spoke and they were made. He commanded and they were created." You can see that on the top here. Another main source for this painting is the book of Genesis, where we read that on the first day, God created heaven and earth. On the second day, God made a division between the sea and the dry land. And on the third day, I quote, "The earth brought forth grass and herb, yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after his kind. And God saw that it was good." What we in fact see in the picture is the whole of dry land covered with exuberant vegetation. Vegetation which, according to the Bible, has an inbuilt drive to grow and multiply. It is not clearly discernible if the fourth day, the creation of the stars, has already passed, yet undoubtedly, this is a decisive moment in God's work. In Bosch's painting, it almost seems as if the Creator is hesitating for a moment to rethink the next step. You see God here in the upper left corner, and I can show you a close-up of God. But of course, the next steps are already determined in God's eternal plan. The script for the creation is in his hands. The next steps are the creation of animal life on day 5 and human life on day 6. If we open the triptych, we can see the result. But before I open it for you, keep in mind that this opening was a ceremonial act. Now, if this triptych, the Garden of Earthly Delights, could have been opened under orthodox conditions in a Christian church, is hotly debated among scholars. The interior of the triptych is one of the most enigmatic paintings in history. Hardly any other painting has provoked more literary activity than this one. And by no means all details have been decoded in any convincing way. However, some things seem to be clear. The painting has three parts. As every triptych in Christian art or Western Christian art, it must be read from left to right. The left panel refers to the account of the Genesis, this time focusing on the fifth and sixth day of the creation. The right panel shows the punishment of the sinners in the afterlife. But what the central panel displays is entirely unclear. I want to make two points to clarify what is to be seen here. First, an adequate understanding of the painting requires a diachronic interpretation. And second, the painting itself makes an original theological argument. About the first argument, modern studies on Hieronymus Bosch have tried to find the key to the complex iconography of the Dutch painter in the political, economic, and intellectual conditions of Bosch's hometown, 's-Hertogenbosch, which is today in southeast Holland. Scholars have also meticulously researched contemporary literature, especially Dutch literature, which may have been available in 's-Hertogenbosch at the time of Hieronymus Bosch. One scholar has finally established a paradigm that no interpretation of Bosch's painting is of any scholarly value if it cannot refer to 15th or 16th century Dutch backgrounds. I call this the synchronistic paradigm, and I think it falls short of a comprehensive understanding of Bosch's art. Instead of synchronism, I do not at all suggest anachronism. On the contrary, I suggest a diachronic interpretation taking into account not only contemporary sources, but also basic texts of the Christian tradition. especially the church fathers, and most especially Augustine of Hippo. I will clarify in a moment why this is necessary. About the second argument, a widespread fallacy among modern art historians is the idea that every element in a work of art must have a parallel in written text. Especially in the case of Hieronymus Bosch and his enigmatic iconography, scholars have left no stone or no leaf unturned to hunt for possible sources of his imagery. In some cases, they did succeed. In even more cases, however, scholars were unsuccessful in decoding picture elements by reading more or less contemporary literature. Nonetheless, the idea remains that the relevant sources have not yet been discovered, and thus the quest continues. This method, which I shall call the graphocentric method, will not necessarily yield the desired result, as it denies the possibility that not only writers but also painters may have original ideas. The only written statement of Bosch on his art that has come down to us claims exactly the opposite. The statement is scribbled on the top of a drawing with the somewhat awkward title, "The Wood Has Ears, The Field Has Eyes." You can read that here. Which is, it's an old German proverb, but I don't want to go into this. The statement is taken from the pseudo-Boeotian treatise De Disciplina Scholarium and reads in Latin, "Miserimi quippe est ingenii semper uti inventis et numquam inveniendis," which could be roughly translated as, "The miserable mind uses only the inventions of others and never its own innovations." Usually this statement is interpreted in a way as to referring to Bosch's innovative style. But why should it not also refer to innovative ideas? As I think, a painter may even be forced to pursue his own particular way of thinking, because in a very different situation than a writer. A philosophical or theological author devoted to the basic question of human existence can devote a certain chapter to a specific problem and another chapter to a different one, and in between he may treat other tricky issues spread out on hundreds of pages. A painter like Bosch, who in his masterpieces aimed at a comprehensive representation of human existence, needs to integrate all the relevant elements into a coherent picture. Consequently, inconsistencies are much more readily apparent. Moreover, a writer may, for instance, give us a theoretical account about human life before the fall. Augustine tells us that human life in paradise was characterized by the absence of sexual lust, the absence of greed, the absence of avarice, the absence of mortality, the absence of pain, the absence of labor, of hatred, of war, of shame, of sickness, and of politics. The reader may find this more or less convincing, but what about a reading painter such as Bosch? He will ask the question, so if life in paradise was devoid of all the things that seem to determine our existence today, what then was life in paradise positively about? How can I paint it? I will return to that question, but first let me say a few words about Hieronymus Bosch. He was born in Sertogenbosch around 1450 into a well-established family. Here you can see Sertogenbosch today. Not much has changed, except maybe the McDonald's restaurant. But Bosch made a very swift career, and in his later period could sell his works for much higher prices than some of the Renaissance champions of the period, such as, for instance, Albrecht Dürer. He made a very fortunate marriage with a daughter of a wealthy merchant and was soon accepted into the economic and political elite of his hometown. Beyond the official magistrates, council, and offices, this elite was organized in a religious congregation, the Brotherhood of Our Lady. The Brotherhood represented the lay piety of the rising merchant and artisan class, but also included nobility and clergy. It had thousands of members inside and outside Sertogenbosch, and most members of Bosch's family, who were also artists, had joined them. If for religious or if for business reasons, is not entirely clear. But the Brotherhood also had a very exclusive and very secretive inner circle. the sworn brothers, only 100 in number, who regarded themselves as the most powerful but also the most pious people in town. Bosch accomplished to enter this inner circle, a quite exceptional achievement for an artist. A surviving document shows his name and profession on the list of this inner circle. You can see here. This secured him the support of a financially strong following and very strong donors. Now, some interpreters have made the claim that Bosch's art expresses the moral convictions of this powerful elite. And this is probably true for his middle period, where the paintings often show scenes from the life of Christ, while the donors are standing by in a pious gesture, often wearing a badge with a lily. You can see that here. This is the symbol of the Brotherhood of Our Lady. But as I think, this interpretation does not work well with his later paintings, such as the Garden of Earthly Delights. In this period, Bosch was already famous, and the higher nobility would pay high prices for a Bosch painting and give him full artistic liberty. Among his customers were illustrious members from the House of Habsburg, such as Philip the Fair, King of Castile. The Garden of Earthly Delights may have been commissioned by the Duke Henry III of Nassau. Yet in this period, we do not find any donor in the paintings. Instead, Bosch's sober view at the human situation becomes fully apparent. All humans are sinful, and the bourgeoisie, the nobility, and the clergy are explicitly included. Very little is known about Bosch's education. He certainly attended the Latin school, that much is known. But what would he have read? He did not write any theoretical treatises about art like his contemporaries Da Vinci and Albrecht Dürer. Or if he did, they are not preserved. None of Bosch's correspondence has survived, nor any other autobiographical material. Yet it is very likely that he used the public libraries of his hometown, especially the ones of the religious community, such as the Brethren of Common Life, who had a strong presence in Zertogenbosch. The Brethren were the main carriers of the Catholic Reform movement, commonly called the Devotio Moderna. We have reasons to assume that also Hieronymus Bosch was strongly influenced by this movement, which determined the religious discourse in the Brotherhood of Our Lady. Some of the earlier paintings of Bosch focus on the motive of devotion and the personal relation between the believer and Christ, as you can see here on the Hermit Saint's triptych. For understanding Bosch, it is highly important to consider that the Devotio Moderna did not so much suggest to read all the pious treatises produced in this period. On the contrary, it suggested to return to the Bible and the commentaries of the Church Fathers, especially Augustine. The whole tradition of scholastic theology and canon law was more or less declared irrelevant. Augustine also was the patron of several religious communities in Zertogenbosch, and as modern scholarship has shown, he held the most prominent place in practically all libraries in town. But there is another reason why someone like Hieronymus Bosch would turn to the Church Fathers. Augustine's City of God simply is the major source for the overarching narrative framework of sacred history. Nobody in Western intellectual history, not the chroniclers, not the scholastics, not the humanists, and not the reformers, have ever provided a comprehensive account of sacred history which aimed to supersede Augustine. On the contrary, without exception, they all relied on him. This basically changes only with the Enlightenment narratives about universal progress, as in Voltaire, or the anti-progressivist counter-narrative of Giambattista Vico. Yet in the time of Hieronymus Bosch, Augustine's account is still without alternative for anyone researching the historical existence of man. The essence of my diachronic argument is that the writings of Augustine provide the key to the larger iconographic program of Bosch's mature work. Before I will explain this in more detail, let me say a few words about the basic structure of the Augustinian narrative. The first book of Augustine's City of God mainly have apologetic character and react to the sack of Rome in 410. More relevant in our context are the 12 books that follow, which contain the constructive part of the work. That is, the history of the world from the creation to the end of time. This narrative presented sacred history as the struggle of two mystical communities, the city of God and the earthly city. The narrative is divided into three major parts. As Augustine himself explains, I quote, and you have to quote here, of these 12 succeeding books, the first four contain the origin, ex ortus, of the two cities. The second four, their course of progress, pro cursus. The third and last four, their appointed ends, debiti fines. Now, the ex ortus, the origin, the beginning or the emergence of the two cities, tells us how the fall of the angels caused a split in the community of heavenly creatures. In order to fill the gap in the heavenly ranks, God created man. But also man fell into sinfulness, and only a few humans will be saved by the grace of God. So the elect of God, together with the loyal angels, constitute the city of God, bound together by the armor Dei, the love of God. While the wicked humans, together with the fallen angels, constitute the earthly city, bound together by the amor sui, self-love. The second part, pro cursus, tells us how the cities evolve in the course of history, beginning with their first representatives, the God-loving Abel, who is slain by his self-loving brother Cain, until their final arrival of the two cities at the end of day, at the end of days. The last part, debiti fines, the third part, tells us about the last judgment where the cities that have mixed in the course of history will finally be separated. The city of God enters heavenly bliss, while the earthly city faces eternal punishment in hell. Now let us return to Hieronymus Bosch. He created three triptychs, which are commonly regarded as his masterpieces. The Garden of Earthly Delights, which is now in the Museo del Prado in Madrid. The Hay Wain, also in the collection of the Prado. And The Last Judgment, which is much closer to us in Vienna, in the Akademie der Bildenden Künste. Now, other than most of the surviving works of Bosch, all the three of them do not represent the life of saints, nor do they show episodes from the Gospels, nor do they have a specific moral content, such as one of the seven deadly sins, but all the three of them take a view at the human situation in general. Recently, Bosch experts have suggested the label eschatological works for these three paintings, but this is, I think, an unjustified overstretch of the concept of eschatology. Out of the three master triptychs, only The Last Judgment displays an eschatological motif on its central panel. Instead, I suggest speaking of Bosch's work on the human predicament. Before I come to the details, let me make the point that all the three triptychs show basically the same patterns. On all the left panels, you see the Garden of Eden. And on all the right panels, you see hell. Only the central panels show the human predicament in different situations. And these situations, I claim, agree exactly with the structure of Augustine's De Civitate Dei. The Last Judgment clearly refers to Augustine's debiti fines, the end of human history. If we for a moment focus only on the central panel, we see Christ as a judge. Yeah. His right hand pointing upward to show the way of the city of God, his left hand pointing downward to indicate the fate of the earthly city. What is displayed in the lower part of the picture is the purgatory, and in the background, the deeper pits of hell. According to a very commonly accepted idea expressed already in the second century by the theologian Tertullian, the tortures in the purgatory would exactly mirror the deeds of the sinner. Here, for instance, we see how gluttony is punished by this person who has to drink some strange juice made of human excrements. Or we see how vanity is punished by attracting the glances of rather uncanny figures. We also see a person being released from the purgatory, taken away by a heavenly messenger. While even in this moment, a demon is trying to assassinate either the man or the angel, it's not clear. And in very remote distance, a few blessed ones are entering the heavenly sphere. That's hardly visible here, but in a close-up, you can see a few souls going to heaven. Now, clearly, Bosch is following the Augustinian calculation about the number of elect. We see only a small group assembled in heaven compared to the masses that go to hell. Now, here we see the Heywain, the triptych devoted to Augustine's second stage, the Procursus. The main symbol we find in Augustine for the human existence at this stage is pilgrimage, peregrinatio. And if we close the triptych for a moment and look at the exterior panels, we can see that pilgrimage is the basic motive. One single upright man is desperately trying to pursue the right path despite all the dangers and distractions. On the side of the way, we see crimes and sin of all kinds, murder, robbery here, adultery, and so on. And in the background, a huge crowd is assembled to enjoy a public hanging. Now, in a contrast to this single man who is on his pilgrimage towards salvation, the mass of the humans are on their course toward hell. That's clearly the direction of the picture. The Heywain symbolizes the vanity of the world, a topic prominent in Augustine's City of God, just as much as in the main treatises of the Devotio Moderna, for instance, the Imitation of Christ by Thomas a Kempis. The hay itself symbolizes the illusionary value of this-worldly pursuits, such as career, wealth, social status, political power, bodily pleasures, and so forth. With a very brutal irony, Hieronymus Bosch shows how people are killing each other for a bunch of hay. You can see that here or there. These are details taken from the spot. Now, nobody, and really nobody, is excluded from the pursuit of hay. Members of all social standings join the procession. The emperor and the popes, as the heads of the temporal and spiritual government, are found just in the middle of the crowd that is mindlessly following the Heywain. You can see them close up. The guides who determine the hellbound direction of the carriage are demons. They are omnipresent in Bosch's work. According to a Christian teaching, the essential character of a demon is deception. He deceives the human by giving them wrong goals in life, by inciting their desires for power, possession, and sex. Now, not a single person is looking upward to Christ except this angel here. Christ being, of course, the real goal of human life. Christ shows the stigmata, the signs of his sacrifice for mankind, but he is totally ignored. Hey signifies the short-term pleasures of this life that sooner or later dissolve into nothingness. Christ signifies eternal life. But as it seems, not a single human is willing to deviate from the sinful course. As often, Bosch gives a special emphasis to the behavior of nuns and monks. We observe them as they collect the biggest of all bunches of hay here down near the close-up, or get drunk, or whatever. The bagpipe, by the way, being a traditional symbol of sexuality. I guess you know why. And this perspective on the clergy and the monks is fairly typical for the contemporary lay religiosity, including the Devotio Moderna. The The lay piety of the 15th century, which is partly the outcome of the Great Schism, which destroyed the remaining trust in the saving power of the clergy and its sacraments, and caused that more and more believers were seeking for alternative ways to secure their redemption. Usually this meant distrust in the priesthood and a personalization and internalization of piety. Lay people founded a large number of smaller or larger congregations, such as Bosch's Brotherhood of Our Lady. Some scholars have counted more than 50 lay congregations only in Bosch's hometown, Sertogen Bosch, which had about 9,000 inhabitants at this time. The church, however, was afraid that such lay communities might easily fall into heresy, and some of them, in fact, did. Therefore, usually monastic orders were commissioned with the supervision of the lay brethren, in the case of Bosch's Brotherhood, the Dominican friars. But in the eyes of many members of these lay communities, this was equal to commissioning wolves with the supervision of sheep. In their pride about pious achievements, which often blended with the pride about economic achievements, they looked down on clerics and monks who often displayed a much more dubious moral life. For instance, when Bosch became a member of the Brotherhood of Our Lady, a sworn member, he had to take an oath to remain eternally faithful to his wife. But of course, in this time, we frequently hear the complaint that the clerics and the monks preach the value of marriage while their concubines constantly change. Sexuality, in general, is a dominant theme in Hieronymus Bosch. He did not believe that something like innocent love was possible in this life. On top of the hay wain, and quite prominent in the general design of the picture, we see a loving couple in a seemingly harmonious scene. They are singing a few songs together, but as you can see, the demon of lust is standing right next to it. And in the next moment, they are disappearing in the bushes. You can see these are the same people with the same dresses. So with this scene in mind, we may now finally turn to the Garden of Earthly Delights. There's a variety of interpretations of this painting. Let me briefly mention just the most prominent one. First, there's a toxicological interpretation which says it's totally impossible that someone painted this without being on drugs. Still prominent. There's a psychological interpretation, which refers to Sigmund Freud and Carl Gustav Jung, and basically wants to recognize representations of psychological archetypes or operations of the unconscious mind in a painting. There is third, the heresiological interpretation. In a very prominent and popular book in 1947, the German scholar Wilhelm Frenger suggested that Hieronymus Bosch may have been a member in an allegedly promiscuous Adamite sect, or the painting may have been commissioned by such an Adamite sect at the occasion of a wedding ceremony and represent the eschatological ideas about a future nudist millenarian paradise. More recently, in 1995, the American scholar Linda Harris has suggested that Bosch may have been under the influence of Qatar Gnosticism. However, both interpretations appear as highly unlikely, considering all the knowledge that has been more recently accumulated about Bosch's customers and his religious affiliation. And there are simply no matches. Moreover, there are no traces of either Adamism or Qatarism in the Netherlands around 1500. Nevertheless, the millenarian and the Gnostic interpretation are certainly over the top, but I think do not deserve a total rejection. Maybe I come back to this topic later. Fourth, there's the moral interpretation. It reads the message of the painting as directly addressing the viewers, basically saying, you are created by God, God gave you commandments, but if you do this, you will end up there. So this, I would say, of course, enriched with thousands of details, is the dominant position today in scholarship. I myself prefer what I would call an existential interpretation. As I said earlier, in his late years, Bosch had achieved the economic liberty to pursue his own ideas with more determination. He no longer depended on customers from the Brotherhood of Our Lady with their particular piety. Hence, moral messages became less important. Instead, he began to focus on the general situation of mankind. As I have tried to show before, his master triptychs follow the tripartite narrative of sacred history as found in Augustine's City of God. Now, in our retrogressive contemplation, we have now arrived at the first stage of Augustine, the ex artus, the origin of mankind. So, as I would like to claim, the central panel of the Garden of Earthly Delights, and you see here, shows nothing else but mankind in the Garden of Eden before the fall. A human society in the state of nature, yet at the same time, a paradise on the brink of collapse. Similar suggestions have been made earlier, but have been rejected by more recent scholarship. For instance, in a 2001 monograph on Bosch, the American scholar Larry Silver writes that we can clearly see typical features of Garden Eden in the picture, but because of the obvious sexual acts occurring in the picture, we are dealing with a post-lapsarian representation of Eden. Unfortunately, this is plain nonsense, because a post-lapsarian Eden is a contradiction in terms. Biblical account says clearly that the expulsion from Eden is an immediate consequence of the fall, and the whole narrative would become meaningless if post-lapsarian mankind would continue living in paradise. The German art historian Stefan Fischer, in a very recent 2009 monograph, insists on the moral interpretation and claims that we are seeing a perversion of divine order, a mock version of paradise with pedagogical intent. Already 10 years earlier, the Dutch Bosch expert Roger Marinissen rejected the Garden Eden interpretation by saying, I quote, "I personally do not see what paragraph of the Genesis one could refer to for speaking about a paradisiacal life of mankind before the fall. If, in any case, Adam and Eve were all alone." Now this is basically correct. According to the book of Genesis, Adam and Eve were alone. They alone committed the original sin, and they alone consequently were expelled from the Garden of Eden. But the statement also shows, if I may say this, the relatively frequent theological illiteracy of modern art historians. Everyone familiar with the writings of the Church Fathers knows that they are obsessed with speculations about the question, what would human existence have looked like if Adam had not sinned? This question in theology is of high systematic necessity, as it asks what God originally wanted human society to look like. In Christian political thought, the speculation about pre-lapsarian human society in paradise has aimed at establishing an ideal picture to which the actual post-lapsarian social life could be compared. The legacy of these political speculations we can still trace in the representations of the natural state by Enlightenment thinkers such as Jean-Jacques Rousseau or John Locke. An extensive speculation of this kind we find again in Augustine's City of God. And because I think that the main message of Bosch's painting lies in a careful but decisive deviation from Augustine, I will first give you the account of the Church Father. Augustine tells us that man was originally created in the likeness of God. That is, his reason had total control over the passions and all the lower functions of the body, just as God, the supreme reason, rules over the lower beings of the universe. The Church Father betrays a Stoic background when he describes the original condition of man as apatheia, as the absence of affects. Literally, quotation that you see here, "Summa in carne sanitas in anima tota tranquillitas." So, roughly a completely healthy flesh and an absolute peace of mind. Politically, this means a total absence of government, Augustine says. Since we read in the book of Genesis that God gave to man the dominion over all other creatures, but nowhere do we read that God gave to humans dominion over other humans. This, of course, was not necessary in paradise because reason endowed the humans with the natural law spelled out in the golden rule. Don't do unto others what you don't want others to do unto you. The golden rule, Augustine says, was perfectly sufficient for organizing social life, which then basically consisted of the natural union of wife and husband. I quote Augustine, "Between husband and wife, there was a loyal partnership springing from honest love. There was harmonious alertness of mind and body and an effortless observance of God's command." But what about sex? How did humans multiply if they were not guided by their passions and instincts as the animals? Now, Augustine has a clear answer, and because I like it so much, you have the complete quote. "Marriage, worthy of the happiness of paradise, should have had desirable fruit without the shame of lust, had there been no sin. But how that could be, there is now no example to teach us. Nevertheless, it ought not to seem incredible that one member," he's speaking of the male sexual organ here, "might serve the will without lust then, since so many serve it now. Do we now move our feet and hands when we will to do the things we would by means of these members? May we not similarly believe that those sexual organs could, like the others, have served mankind by obedience to the decision of the will for the generation of children, even if there had been no lust inflicted as punishment for the obedience of, for the sin of disobedience? Under those circumstances, the organ created for this work would have sown its seed upon the field of generation as the hand does now upon the earth." End of quote. So in other words, sexual intercourse in paradise was a fully rational act. Only when, as a result of original sin, humans lost their rational control over the passions, sexuality became determined by concupiscencia, sexual lust. And this exactly is the point where Bosch differs from the classical account of the Church Father. Now let me illustrate the argument by returning to the three triptychs. Well, as we have seen, all the triptychs show in the left panel the Garden of Eden. Now, I want to make an experiment. I just put for you next to each other all the left panels of the triptychs. So, you see that both representations of the paradise in the Last Judgment and in the Haywain show the typical features that you would expect. You see the fall of the angels and the war in heaven. You see the creation and blessing of Adam and Eve. You see the fall with the serpent and the forbidden tree. And you see the expulsion from Eden. The left panel of the Garden of Earthly Delights, however, differs decisively. The cosmological myth of the fall of the angels is completely cut out. Neither the fall nor the expulsion is depicted. Instead, the image focuses on the creation of animals and humans on the fifth and sixth day of God's work. Now, let's look at this left panel in a little bit more detail. We see how life emerges from the creation. We see here how the birds fly up into the sky. We see how various animals are drinking from the fountain of life here. We see how all kinds of reptiles are crawling out of the water. If I go to the next picture, we see something a little bit more disturbing. No? It is a dark pond, I call it, which seems to bring forth all kinds of uncanny creatures, including a scholastic fish here. But there are more elements in the picture that disturb the idyllic scene. Like here in the background, in a close-up, you can see there's a moment of killing. Some predator animal killing a deer. Another act of aggression here. Another moment of killing here. That's here, it's very small. And even smaller, here in this corner, you see a real massacre, a frog massacre. And what is really uncanny about that, even if you say that, you know, these animals kill in order to survive, it is not fully clear if this massacre not also includes some type of lustful killing. Let's go to the next picture. Placed exactly in the center of the picture is the fountain of life. In the middle of it, there is a strange form, a kind of a mixture between a plant and a monstrance. I show you here a monstrance. I took one from Estergom as an example, so you can see the similarity in structure. The figure seems to represent life itself, as it combines the pinkish color of human flesh with the shape of a plant, and the ceremonial vessel containing the vivifying body of Christ. Yet exactly in the center of this round-shaped container, where in the monstrance the Eucharist would be kept, we see a little owl. You see it? Yeah. Now in Bosch, the owl does not signify wisdom, but seduction. And this is related to bird hunting practices of the time, where an owl was glued to a tree as a kind of bait, because singing birds, recognizing a chance that they could hurt an enemy, would attack the owl and themselves get caught in the glue spread on the branches. This combination of singing birds signifying desires and the owl as the seducing but misleading goal of their desires is a frequent motive in Bosch's painting. I'll show you a few examples. You have seen that already. You remember the couple on the hay bane, but you have probably not recognized the owl and the bird. Yeah. So these are just several drawings and sketches where you have the motif of owl and birds. The scene in the foreground shows us the moment after Eve has been created from Adam's rib. Adam, just awakening from anesthesia, is somehow confusedly looking at this new female fellow, not quite knowing what to do with her. But God, of course, instantaneously gives the answer. I quote from the Bible. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. So the multiplication, which is only possible through a sexual act, is willed by God. But how would it work? In the same way as Augustine describes it, exactly at this point, Bosch decided to disagree. Now, let's first look a little bit closer at the faces of Adam and Eve. They quite typically represent what Bosch thought were the basic character traits of men and women. The woman seemingly devout, with downcast eyes, but also with an inscrutable Mona Lisa-like smile, as if she couldn't wait to start the business of multiplying. The man rather stupid and ready to walk into every trap set by the woman. Now, many interpreters have called Bosch a misogynist, but this is only true if you prefer stupidity over comedy. So, in any case, the most subversive element in the picture is that little rabbit next to it. I call it the deconstructivist rabbit. But, now, what does it signify? I think simply one thing. Bosch did not wish to make such a huge difference between humans and other living creatures as Augustine did. Plants and animals, especially rabbits, have an impulse drive toward multiplication. This is the law of nature. And there's no reason why man, in the state of nature, should be so totally exempted from it. So let us just conclude at this point that Bosch's representation of paradise is deeply ambiguous. Now let me return to my argument that the central panel of the Garden of Earthly Delights shows how mankind would have lived in paradise if Adam had not sinned. My first point is that the fall is not depicted, as in other Bosch's paintings on the paradise. My second point is that there is an obvious continuity of landscape from the left panel to the center panel, as you can see, while the right panel is in this respect totally disconnected. My third point is that the central panel shows the typical elements of paradise. We see the four rivers here, that spring from the Garden of Eden, Fishon, Gihon, Tigris, Euphrates. Secondly, everyone's naked and nobody feels ashamed. All persons seem to have perfectly shaped bodies and everybody seems to be in their early 20s. Now, as described by the church father Augustine, nobody is expecting any cold or heat. The weather is always pleasant. Nobody needs to work and nobody needs to sleep. What could be more idyllic than a young man plucking flowers from the backside of his friends? And there seems to be an abundance of food. Over-dimensioned fruits are growing on trees all around. You see here the grapes and so on. This is, as I think, a reference to another early Christian writer, Irenaeus of Lyon, who describes this over-dimensioned fruits in paradise. Now, in the far distance, we see a person being lifted up into heaven, exactly like Augustine described it, because before the fall, there was no mortality. After a certain testing period, humans would have been taken off to heaven without undergoing death and resurrection. Finally, the clearest sign, I think, is the absence of Christ, as in the other central panels that you have seen, probably because there is not yet any necessity for a savior. The narrative in Paul's letter to the Romans tells us that Christ came into this world as a result of Adam's sin, as a kind of a second Adam who would restore mankind. If the painting shows a prelapsarian situation, then the absence of Christ is plausible. But again, what about sexuality? Do we really see orgiastic sexuality that so many interpreters have observed and that let them reject the idea of a prelapsarian mankind? I just show you some of the close-ups of the loving couples in the picture. Oh, this one is taken here, can barely see it here, very small in the background. This one here, and here this interracial loving scene is taken from here. It rather seems to me that we are observing the type of innocent paradisiacal love that Augustine described, or Irenaeus of Lyon that I just mentioned. I'll give you a quote from Irenaeus. "They were not ashamed, kissing and embracing each other in purity after the manner of children. And childishness, in fact, is a keyword. Since Bosch, as a painter, also had to ask the question what people were doing all day in paradise if there was neither work nor sleep." You can see that here. "And what humans in paradise are doing are mostly utterly childish things. You know? Like children on a playground, they would climb the highest tree, engage in strange gymnastic exercises, and so on." You can see that's all scenes from up here that I show you here in the close-ups. This one is taken here from this bowl. But what if the exercises get boring? Would they not invent increasingly silly games? Now, undeniably, the wildest scene is placed in the center of the picture. The chase of the young men around the pool of the girls. As it seems, there is a strict gender separation in the game and no orgiastic intermingling, as so many more Puritan interpreters came to see here. Here it's that part of the picture. However, the building has more than just one dimension. Occasionally, I know that doesn't sound methodologically sound, but occasionally one can almost observe the painter thinking by looking at the picture. Apparently, Bosch was asking himself, So why did Adam fall? How could he fall? Now what does Augustine say? Adam could fall because he was endowed with free will. So he could freely obey God's command, but also follow his lower desires. But when he sinned, he was deprived of his free will. Instead, he is dominated by his passions and may only be saved by the grace of God. Well, Bosch seems to ask, if Adam had not sinned, and mankind would have multiplied in paradise, would not the situation of Adam always remain the same? Would then not all the humans still be endowed with the free will? But this would mean that the paradise would remain a terribly fragile situation. And this is, I think, what Bosch wants to show us, and which is, you know, totally absent, this consideration, in the work of Augustine. Now, this fragility is depicted in a variety of ways, and apparently, Bosch wanted to show us exactly the moment of collapse. Now, here we see a few of these young ladies, which show typical signs of vanity. You know, the peacock, the apples, you know, the story from the Iliad, the beauty contest, but also an apple as a symbol of Eve's loss of innocence. They refer to the deadly sin of superbia. Here, we see a girl climbing out of the pool and heading toward the guys. Here, if you look at the animals that the men are riding, you know, they have swollen testicles, obviously signaling some kind of sexual readiness. If we look again at this loving couple that we have just seen, they seem to be happy and safe in their sphere, but you can also see that the sphere has cracks. Now, the owl again is very prominent in the whole picture. You know, here you see three dancing men which have just one head shaped like an owl. One man, you know, happily embracing the owl, you know, meaning seduction. Here these men have just spotted the owl and seem to agree on targeting it now. But the full ambiguity of the painting becomes apparent if we have a look, a close look, at the center right section. I show you the section now. As it is clearly discernible, one of the animals, written by an ecstatic young man, has a phallus-shaped head. So this seems almost like a counterstatement to Augustine's idea of rationally operated sexual organs in paradise. We can see one couple that may be dancing here, but if you look at the man, he has a very guilty face and the woman a very scared face, so it's not entirely clear if this is consensual, what is happening here. You see three men with very unhealthy body color eating a grape, so the overabundance of food might easily collapse into another deadly sin, gula in Latin or gluttony. You see a man who is obviously in a state of melancholy, which then often was associated with the deadly sin of sloth, of accidia. And very hard to see if you see it in here, but in the background, very gloomy looking man who obviously were not so lucky in finding a mating partner and are now looking at all that happiness and playfulness going on in paradise, but maybe with a sense of envy, where we have another deadly sin. So only in this small section of the Garden of Eden, the beginnings of four deadly sins are depicted. Now the clearest scene of unrestrained sexual lust is almost the most hidden scene in the picture at all. It is here. Now even if you would stand for the original, you would hardly see it. But of course we have modern technology, so I can zoom it to the foreground for you. So, in a cave, right in the center of paradise, from where the four vivifying rivers spring, we can observe a scene which is downright pornographic. A bearded and uncivilized looking man is going directly for the most private parts of a seemingly surprised and shocked young lady. The scene does not at all display the innocent type of love which is placed more in the foreground of the picture. In this scene, the fall of man has already happened. Now let me come to my final evaluation of the painting. From the earliest beginnings of Western Latin Christianity, the situation of man has been expressed in legal terms. In the Latin translations, the language of the gospel underwent a juridification. A perfect example is the concept of sin. When the Greek New Testament was called hamartia, failure or deviation, became in Latin peccatum, crime. But also the whole narrative of human historical existence was translated into judicial proceedings. Augustine provided the paradigmatic formulation, but it has been confirmed by the Catholic theologian Thomas Aquinas, just as much as by the Protestant lawyer John Calvin. Adam had sinned voluntarily against the divine law. And since he was the ancestor of all mankind has sinned in him. Mankind is a sinful mass, a massa peccati, as Augustine called it. Therefore, all humans are justifiably punished, not only by a miserable existence in this life, but also by eternal chastisement in the beyond. If some humans are exempted from punishment, this is only due to a totally undeserved act of grace from the side of God, the supreme judge. Augustine also said that on Judgment Day, when we will look back on the course of human history, every detail of it, every disease, every war, every disaster, everything that might appear tragic to us now, will then be known as just and absolutely necessary. If I read Bosch's painting correctly, then he is introducing into the Christian narrative a dimension of human existence that had been abolished by the church fathers, the dimension of tragedy. The tragic dimension is essential for the representation of human existence in the arts, in painting, or in drama. Therefore, we often find a protest against the rigid judicial logic of the Augustinian paradigm in the works of religiously sensitive poets, such as John Milton, Johann Wolfgang Goethe, or an example from Hungary, Imre Mordach. These poets did not aim at a total rejection of the Augustinian paradigm, as in Enlightenment philosophy. These poets, just like Hieronymus Bosch, follow the Augustinian narrative, but modify it by reintroducing tragedy. This means, more precisely, that they doubt the full legal culpability of man. They are not Gnostics in the sense that they describe the creation as evil throughout and God as evil. No, as we have seen, they rather detect some ambivalence, some ambiguity in the original condition of divine creation. In the details, of course, they differ. In Goethe or Mordach, man is created with inborn curiosity and the desire to know, wherefore he was determined to eat the forbidden fruit. In Milton, we have the idea of some dark dimension originally implied in the creation. But in Bosch, the emphasis is on human sexuality. Man would not have been able to fulfill the divine command to multiply if he had not fully participated in the drives, the instincts, and the desires of living nature. Yet this implied that the desires could at any time degenerate into lust and unrestrained passion. If Adam had not sinned, somebody else had done it, sooner or later. Maybe a bearded guy in a hidden cave. In other words, in Bosch's representation of human sinfulness, there is a sense of inevitability. And therefore, the miserable, laborious, and vain character of human life, just as much as the tortures of the beyond, are not simply justified punishments, they are also a tragedy. This, however, sheds new light on the character of God. He foresaw the tragedy of human existence, but he willingly accepted it as a part of his work, even though he may briefly have hesitated on the third day of creation. And now let's look at representations of God in paintings of Bosch. The Christian God, that's not just the Father, the Creator. He's also the Son, the Redeemer. And if we for a moment look at these representations, we detect a difference in character. We see a detached Father, all kinds of wars going on under him, over here, and a concerned son. The father remains eternally in his transcendent immutability while the son becomes man. Contrary to the letter of the Genesis, Bosch's painting, Garden of Earthly Delights, makes Christ appear in paradise, and not the Father. The Son is speaking the blessing over Adam and Eve. And this basically should be a happy moment, but his face expression could be not more concerned. Christ knows exactly what is coming, and he's looking directly into the eyes of the viewers, almost as if to say sorry. Bosch's Christ is a much more human Christ than the Christ of Augustine. It is the Christ of the Devotio Moderna, a Christ who has sacrificed himself out of compassion for mankind. He is human and feels with the humans. This does not imply a rebellion against the Father, but an attempt to modify the rigid script of the Father. It is an attempt to provide a way out for the ones who acknowledge the sacrificial character of incarnation, passion, and crucifixions. For the ones who are willing to imitate Christ and willingly accept suffering. Therefore, Bosch's Christ almost desperately shows the stigmata, the visible signs of his sacrifice. Yet the second part of the tragedy is the tragedy of Christ, whose sacrifice is largely ignored by the humans, as depicted in the triptych of the Hieronymus. If this character difference between the Father and the Son, between the Creator and the Savior, would have been expressed in the written word, in a theological treatise, it would have been suspicious. In theological terminology, a difference in character would inevitably become a difference in essence, which is heresy. But the painter has different means. He can allow for more ambiguity and leave more room for interpretation. Let me conclude. What I see in the Garden of Earthly Delights is the attempt of a partial exoneration of man from the guilt of original sin. Humans fell into sin, but they fell in their capacity as divine creatures. God certainly created the best of all possible worlds, but it still contained the seeds of fallibility. If I'm right, then Hieronymus Bosch is a part of a long tradition of Christian thinkers and artists who did not, as Augustine, aim at the defense of God in the face of evil and suffering, but who were rather aiming at the defense of man in the face of sinfulness. Bosch does not look at the human predicament primarily as a deserved punishment for original sin, but rather as the tragic consequence of the inevitable fall of man. And since, traditionally, a sense of tragedy also comes with a sense of comedy, we can now enjoy Bosch's vision of the playful foolishness of original mankind, if they only had been granted some more time in paradise. Thank you very much.